Welcome to the In My Opinion Show with Ronald Barrington Robinson and friends. With us, we have Mrs. Jackie Williams.
Good afternoon, everyone.
We have Mr. Michael Kelly.
Hello.
And we have Mr. Henry Hatter.
Good afternoon, Ron.
Welcome all to our millions of viewers worldwide. Let's talk about DACA, which means Deferred Action for Childhood Arrivals, or the DREAM Act. Some sources say there could be as many as 11 to 20 million illegal aliens in the U.S. from all over the world. This has been quite a topic as of late, and I really don't understand why we're putting these dreamers in the mix with this so-called wall that President Trump is trying to build. He's not going to get that. He's not going to get that. In my opinion, he's not going to get that wall built. I hope we don't. He lied about Mexican is going to build it. Mexican's going to build it. You know. But before I get started with his lying, Henry, you being the resident Republican, give our viewers of in-depth view of your thoughts on that.
Well, this is a sovereign nation. We're internalized by boundaries, and there are rules for coming into the country, into every country, not only the United States, but every other country. And our the people that we let in the country should be legally documented to come here. That's the practice. That's the protocol. But it's unfortunate there is two segments to this argument over DACA. One is those who came in illegally. The other are on their own. And the other is the ones who came as no fault of their own. Now, it's hard to divide that. A just man or just woman would have difficulty dividing that. And I have some sympathy for the young people who came here as babies or whatever, not of their own accord, but who were dragged in. And we should give that more thought. But the other people should come in, should be gauged and judged by their own actions.
Well, let's look at it this way. What about the ones, okay, that came in with their parents? They have grown up here in the United States,
yeah,
okay? But it appears that they're trying to lump all of this into one, you know, into one one bowl here, and it's wrong, okay?
And that's what I said in my initial statement, that there are two segments.
But I think we need to realize we're watching political theater.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
We are watching people, for example, the administration or the president, whenever he talks about DACA, he talks about illegal aliens who are pouring in our borders and the Democrats wanted to let them all in and all this, which in fact isn't at all true.
Mm-hmm.
The specific case of DACA refers, as Henry described and you have described, a very small group of people, it's about 800,000 is the number I've seen, that are people who are Brundage's children, right? I mean, that is not, if you want to let the people who basically came in here at 4 and 5 and 6 and have grown up here and they have lived their life, they don't know, they can't go back to El Salvador, they don't know anything about El Salvador or whatever country they came from originally or their family came from. But in the discussions of it, we keep trying to conflate it, because the problem I have with American politics right now is we don't try to educate, we try to push you to our opinion, and there's dishonesty.
Yes.
If we could take all the other issues off the table, and I understand the desire to have control of borders, I understand that, but to try and talk about, oh, they're rapists, they're criminals, they're terrible people, by and large, the immigrants have less crime the native-born Americans. They have higher education. Immigrants work hard. I mean, the idea of people saying they come to America and sit around and draw welfare, that's crazy.
It is.
Immigrants are working 4 jobs. They didn't go to all this trouble to come here and lay around.
One of the main problems is what Henry's very famous words, is the paradigm. Is it the paradigm shift?
Yeah, the paradigm. Oh, yeah. Oh, you mean how?
Because
white
I think what it.
That's the browning of America.
Exactly.
Okay,
yeah.
So I think what the real problem is that they see the picture. They see the picture on down the line, and what the picture is looking like, it's not looking like them. So they're starting to get, you know, they're trying to make moves right now to avoid, but it's too late because it's going to happen. So when you, so what you do is you build up all these walls, so you don't have to build a wall. So in Mexico, because you're building a wall in the United States, so you're telling me now that, you know, all of these people who don't know anything, like you said, about where they came from, who are innocent in this, it's not fair to them that you're holding them as a pawn to do something else where you have another intent. So like you said, we're not being honest. We're, you know, we have another intent. The intent is not to allow America to continue to brown, because as he was caught saying, and I really believe the Democrat, not because he's Democrat, because he never changed the story, that you don't want other people to come here. You want just people to come here to look like you, that have money. You don't want anybody to have another chance. But what if we went back through, because they told me that his family didn't do very well when they first got here. So they were, they had a chance to branch off. So why can't everybody else have a chance at, you know, making America great, as you would call it, and making America great again? So it is, it's not the same rules on both sides. It's not the same rules on both sides.
I think you make a very strong point, and I think we need to look back at history. This is not the first time people have been scared of immigrants. I'm an Irish Catholic, right? I'm well in the acceptable realm, right? But not in the old days, not in the 1850s, 1860s, 1870s. They were like, oh my God, these Irish Catholics, they drink too much, they have too many children, they're lazy, they're ignorant. Same thing with the Italians, same thing with the Poles. Every group that comes in gets the same treatment. Now, we're not talking about people from Europe, we're talking about people from Latin America, we're talking about people from Asia, Africa. We are a world country. The United States of America is a world country. Just look at our Olympic teams. Next month we're gonna go to the Olympics, right? Now you watch that parade. I love the parade at the beginning of the Olympics, right? You see every nation behind their flag and the team. The people from Burma are Burmese. You know, the people from Norway are Norwegian. The American team comes out, we're the world. We are a world nation. Right now, Japan is losing population radically because Japan never allowed immigration. There have been Koreans living there for three generations, still not citizens. Japan is going to have 60% of its population in the middle of this century. They are going to drop the vast amount of population. What do you do with an industrial democracy when you have 60% of the population you had a generation ago? What has kept this country healthy and strong has been that we continue to get people, and they're not the lazy people. The lazy people didn't leave. The lazy people stay at home. Immigrants, you, whether it's legal or illegal, you went to a lot of trouble to get here, and you're coming here, you know, we talk about entrepreneurs. Good heavens, look at the Arabs. Every Syrian, every Iraqi comes over, they want to open a store. Arabs are shopkeepers. That's what they do. This keeps our country strong, but we fought it every time. We fought it 100 years ago. People who are now fighting against the next guy in, their parents were fought when they came here.
But I think one of the things that exacerbate this argument is that many immigrants coming in this country don't want to become Americanized. They don't want, they want to maintain their own rules and regulations and laws, as some did when they came into Genesee County and they wanted to begin schools that were associated with their.
But we've always done that. Well, we have schools, we have Lutheran schools, Jewish schools, Catholic schools, public schools. And the Republican Party, which you and I used to be on the same side, we probably aren't anymore, they're taking the money out of the public schools. They're giving it to all these. And if you're going to set up a private school and you say, we're going to take tax money and give it to private schools, fine, but don't come complaining when the black Muslims set up a school, man. That's the deal. If the Catholics can do it, the Muslims can do it.
Give them their share.
Yeah, that's the deal.
Yeah, but the deal is state law.
No, right. That's what the deal is. The deal is that we learned your game. and we played the game. That's the deal. We learned the game and we played the game, and you're not happy because they came in at no fault of their own, and they even did a background. All of the immigrants, they have high GPAs. The DACA.
Oh, without a doubt, I know that.
So yeah. they're not causing America any problems. Matter of fact, what the economic has said is that if we take them out, we're going to feel it because they pay taxes.
How are schools funded in Michigan or the United States? How are they funded?
By taxes.
And is that criteria to receive those funds? Yes, there is. You know what it is? You cannot deny any person from attending. And this has happened. That was what led to this, and you may be familiar with it. And I don't want to exacerbate relations between two different cultures by speaking about that. But those of us.
But I hear from a lot of people, and maybe you give me an example. I hear people saying, "Why are you going down to Dearborn? Sharia law is in control." Yeah. Well, show me. Give me an example. You show me one case other than voluntary. Sometimes people will say, you know, we're not going to go to the courts. Mm-hmm. It could be a mediation through the court system, or it could be we're going to the pastor or the imam or whatever. We're going to go talk. We're going to work this out ourselves and not go to court. Well, then that's a good thing, not a bad thing. But you always have the right to go to court. If you want to go to court, you can. But I keep hearing about Sharia law in the U.S., but I never see it. I just hear talk about it.
I don't see it either. But
okay. Yeah. So we really shouldn't talk about that kind of stuff, should we?
Well, it's out there.
The talk is out there, but I don't know if the...
If it applies.
Yeah,
we just use it. That's what he's saying. We just use it. You know, we can give a whole bunch of examples of
but
that.
But I know examples where... there was a school intended to build a school, and the ISD shut it down because it didn't invite other kids, African Americans or the typical white Americans and others. So do you think, that my question is, do you think that immigrants should adopt the criteria of becoming assimilated into the United States?
Well, that I mean, they have
to follow rules. It's laws.
They have to abide. They have to abide by rules just like we do. They shouldn't be, you know, exempt from anything. That's
Dearborn is a good example
because it has the highest population of Arabics. I understand that. So is that why you're saying that? Because they have a high population.
No,
what are you saying?
Just discussions I've heard from other people.
But what have you heard?
Are they intimidated by it?
I don't know.
Are they intimidated by it? Because they thought that when all this stuff was going on, they thought they were going to tear up Dearborn. Because they said they're going to tear Dearborn. Dearborn is not. Mm-hmm. Been damaged. So everybody always do all these hypes that they're going to do all these different things. Only hype is right now over 80% of Americans believe that we should adopt DACA to make them citizens. And then I heard your president say the other day out of one side of his mouth that some proposal he had where it would take up to 12 years.
Yeah, but see, we're putting issues on the table that people need to evaluate and take a look at. And this is one of them. This is a hot issue. This is what keeps the country divided. We don't want to investigate these or just have discussions about them. Whether they're right in your mind or wrong.
And
we need to have
you know what? And this is one place where I thought I would never be so upset with my Democrats, but I am. Because I feel like they did not make a good decision.
On what?
On they should have not folded. They got nothing out of the deal because I can't trust what's his name?
Schumer. You're talking about the government shutdown.
Schumer took it, but I'm saying I can't trust what's his name?
The president?
No, the
Well, there are a lot of people you can't trust.
What's his name? The one that McConnell.
Oh, Mitch McConnell.
I can't trust him. He talks out both sides of his mouth, just like his president.
No, he says things very carefully.
No, not carefully.
And you may not like what he says, but...
Because he'll say, just like your president, he'll come and make a decision. And this is just...
Would you call him the president?
No.
Yeah, just call him the president.
I will respect you, Henry.
Thank you.
The president. When he...
As much as your fellow Republicans... We're respectful of President Obama.
That's right.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Right. So he would come and he would make a deal. And this is what we're talking about. It goes back to leadership, poor leadership, because this president he is not able to go in. Like you said, I'm the negotiation person. I can make negotiations and I can do that. He's not able to deliver because as soon as he get out there and start running his mouth, they come back and damage control is working 24 hours to fix all the stuff that he's promised. So Schumer and the president had worked out somewhat an agreement. As soon as he got back to the White House, they said it's a 32-year-old young Republican in the House is running things that the president, he's overriding.
Steve Miller.
Thank you. He's overriding the president. They said that they don't know who this guy is. They say he's inexperienced, but he is like shutting down every negotiation that the president is making. That's poor leadership. We did not elect him to be the president. If you don't have the know-how to be the president, then move out of the way so we can move on with these issues, because every time we move forward, he go back to the White House and then they backtrack everything that he's
said. But you're looking at all the negative things about this, but there's some positive things that's underlying this. Look at how, for example, employment has changed in this country. Look how deep S&P has grown.
But Henry, this is a continuation of a trend that was set 8 years ago. The thing has been going straight up,
and more of that work to do.
This administration has made that happen. This administration,
but they have started to see a slope in the employment. They said finally all of these regulations that you have done and all of these backdoor deals. So it is starting to slope back the other way.
Well, it's too early.
And watch and see.
The trend. You got to look at the trend.
But you have to understand, the administration is, the things that the administration has done are just starting now to come into effect. I mean, you didn't walk in on January 20th or whatever inauguration day, and all of a sudden everything changed. No.
Nothing changed.
Nothing changed for months and months and months.
It's got momentum.
But the question is, if a year from now stock market's gone down, which I hope it doesn't, but I suspect it will because it's gone a long way awfully fast, and unemployment starts to go up again, are you going to say, well, it's the president's fault, or are you going to say, well, it's somebody else's fault? Because what happens in the industry is if you're there, if you're the governor or the president or whatever, and things are good, you're a genius, and if things are bad, you're an idiot. Most of the time, it's not the president or the Congress that does that much to affect the economy.
That's politics. But must be looking for the thinking people in the United States, they must be looking for a continuum. When we're going good, we want to keep it going good. And we know that part of this was started by Obama, but we need to keep the growth going. We don't want to. And we need to look at the positive aspects of this. And that, there's a positive aspect. And I think that you admit that Obama started this. And it's still going in the same direction.
Trump hasn't killed the economy yet. I'll give you that.
But there is some signs, just like, say for instance, I got to tell you the truth. There is some signs, just like Walmart said that they were going to give all these bonuses out. Okay, well, they, just like their president, they like to say stuff and then go back and retract. They were going to give $1,000 bonuses to all of their employees. Then they came back and said, oh, no, not all of them. The ones that's been here 20 years. Who has worked at Walmart 20 years besides a few people? And then they rolled it back and said, oh, we're not doing well. They closed 65 Sam's. See, that's what I'm saying. This stuff, like they were saying on the news, this stuff is not reported like it should be reported. Because you might have gave $1,000 to people that were there 20 years, but you also closed 65 Sam's without any notification.
If you were the CEO of that Walmart, what would you do when business climate changes?
So isn't that an indication that the economy is slowly going down?
No, that just means that you can...
Walmart is the largest company in the world.
With the conditions around you.
But there are other forces at work, too. Yeah. I mean, retail stores are dying out.
Exactly. You
know, because people are ordering from Amazon and other online things.
And now they're trying to reverse it. It's so funny. They're trying to reverse it. So now they'll tell you to go in the store. Don't buy it online. It's higher online.
Yeah.
Go in the store because they realize that they opted themselves out of the retail. So now they're trying to fix something that they've created. But that's not the problem with Walmart. What they're doing is they make all of this money, and they also are the number one employer that have people that are on state aid. Did you know that? You know how much you guys hate that.
We are subsidizing the Walton family. And they are the richest people in the
country. We are subsidizing all of their employees because they don't pay them enough to get insurance. They don't pay them enough. They get food stamps.
That's why they have employment. You can't make everybody rich. No business can do that.
We're not talking about making them rich, but they're...
That's a part of government's responsibility.
Only when it accommodates your theory.
Businesses are in business to make money.
Yes, yeah. I agree, but I do believe government has a role in seeing that there is some fairness in the marketplace. And when I hear people say, "We got to cut all these regulations. We got to cut the regulations. Cut all this red tape." Where did the regulations come from? It came from problems. There was pollution. There was injustice in employment. Then we come up with regulations. Sometimes they're a little blunt instruments. They don't quite work as well as we'd like. But to simply take a viewpoint, as unfortunately many people do, regulation is bad. We want open marketplace. We had it. It was called the Wild West. we'll settle that at noon out in the town square with guns, my God. Government is there to try to have some justice. Now, when government itself is unjust, which happens then you got other issues. But I think to take a view, which we have now for over a generation, something like half the country believes the government is the enemy, which it was very easy to go from that to other Americans are the enemy, and we're in a position now where we are losing that sense that, look, I live in Michigan. I care more about somebody in Maine or New Mexico than I do about somebody in Hungary, all right? Hungary's a nice country, nothing gets to Hungarians, but Americans, that's more my responsibility. I mean, I take on a responsibility in a shared community. We have, for a generation, been attacking the very idea of collaborative and cooperative activity. It's derided as socialism. We've attacked the public schools. We've attacked all of our institutions. And this administration right now, the thing that worries me about President Trump, and Henry, you and I have fought on the same side for years and years and years, but we have crossed the line in this country. He attacks education. He attacks the press, which, by the way, was the First Amendment, not the Second Amendment. He attacks knowledge. He attacks the education institutions. They attack the law enforcement institutions. We are at the point where the only thing to be believed is the opinion of the great leader. Everything else is to be thrown out the door. And when we get there, we're in big trouble.
What does that look like?
An authoritarian state.
That's right.
You're right about education. He attacks education. But there are times when you should attack education. Because when education is not functioning right, and we have more kids doing badly in school than we did a generation or two generations, or back during the First World or Second World War, our country was going up. Our standards were up, and we were achieving high standards, and kids were learning a lot.
That's right.
And today, that's not true.
How much money has been taken out of the public education system over the last generation? Hundreds of billions.
When we were in school, they groomed us. They groomed us to know how to cook. They groomed us to know how to sew a little bit. We had skills and all different stuff.
Right.
Now all of that stuff is gone, Henry.
But that's what we have to look at our education system and improve it.
Yeah.
And you can't improve it by saying it's a great system.
Never taught in a classroom. She has no experience to bring to the table. I'm going to give you another example.
You don't have to be a teacher about education.
But you can be educated.
You can't tell me that
an educated person appreciates education more than somebody who has never went that way. They do. They appreciate it.
I wouldn't say that she's not educated.
She's not educated.
She's just not an educator.
Amway is not an education. Hear ye. Amway is not an education.
But she is She has no experience. You say she is unprepared.
Yes.
But I'm sure she probably has a bachelor's degree. I would. They've got enough money. I'm sure she's got a degree.
When they did it, they said she didn't have it.
I think she's never taught in a public school. She's never had any kids in a public school.
Because I didn't see that she had a degree.
Thomas Edison and
you had to go back to him. That's sad. You had to go back to him to get an
education.
Example.
Look what they built.
What year was that?
It doesn't matter, but look what
my point is. She's not building right now. So if you're saying that we're hurting, she's not even listening to the people who are in the classroom. She's standing on the outside. You can't fix something on the inside when you're outside sitting in the playground. You can't do it.
Give me an example.
Example.
Well, she's failing.
Because the teachers are coming to her and they said when she comes into the school, it's just for a photo shoot.
How do they know? Did they ask her?
They're asking questions, please. And she's not able to respond.
Ask a question about what? How many in this class is getting a proficient? She wouldn't know that. I wouldn't know that either. And you wouldn't know it.
But I have.
And here's an educator, and he wouldn't know.
Documentation would show you.
Well, it qualifies her to be Secretary of Education. What qualifies her to be
her donation position. To
her 3 or 4
her,
million that she
her
contributed
donation.
To Trump?
She was to. And she wants to be that. And she has the education, the knowledge, the presence in public policy.
Okay, I'm gonna hit you in your house. You are on the board.
Yes.
What qualifies you to be on the board?
I live in the community.
And what else?
That's all I need.
Henry, you are not on the board with a whole bunch of people to just live in a community and do nothing.
But that you say whatever.
What are the qualifications of the people that serve with you, Henry? I know we gotta go up higher. Come on.
Well, I have a bachelor's degree and I live in the community. The community is the biggest.
That's the legal requirement.
Yeah,
registered legal. Voter yeah. in the school district.
Right.
Yeah. So you said what?
And I'm sure there are very good school board members out there who have not higher
right.
education. And there are other very educated people that are terrible at their jobs.
Because they can't apply.
But
right.
I think the bigger issue is that they have been given less and less to work with. You know, you've sat there looking at the budgets for years. You know every year. There is less and less and less to work with.
But to respond to your question, how much help and what they have schools lost over the last generation, it's a humongous amount.
Yes.
But you can tell.
Part of that.
But you also understand, there are people who will tell you right today, we have to cut taxes. Look, they just did it down in Lansing this week. Cut taxes again. Every 2 years, every group's got to come back and say, I got you a tax cut. You can't keep cutting and cutting and cutting and cutting forever and say, why is it our students aren't doing well? Why are our bridges
times.
Falling apart? You know, at a certain point in time, if you're going to live in a civilized society, you take care of each other in ways like, look, I can't build a bridge by myself, but if all of us in the community get together and decide we couldn't build this bridge, then we can do it. Certain things are beyond the individual. Now, we're getting to the point where these multi-billionaires out there, they're already getting to having private armies. We are going to get into a world where we're going to turn into like a science fiction movie, some third world country where the big guy who's got his 50 armed men in the backyard, he's going to tell everybody what to do. We've been there.
You mean like the Little Rocket Man?
Yeah, well, we've been there. We have done this before in human history. Civilization grew because we didn't want to always be beaten up over. If it came down to we'll just get one big boss,
we'll
get all the little bosses out of our hair. You know?
With that, we must bring In My Opinion show to a close.
That was
this has been very, very interesting conversation. Until next time, this is Ronald Barrington Robinson and friends saying, stay focused.